So now that the TGS event for Persona is finally over, what did you think about it?
The dream is dead.
Almost. I mean, it's not dead. It's just delayed a tiny bit. I mean,
the dream has been nullified for the time
being. The dream is still dreaming. I don't know what that means.
if you saw my Twitter those past few days on TGS, I blew up.
I did. I mean, I don't know. I'm okay with the delay personally. I don't mind it. Now they've said it's the biggest game Atlus has ever produced. I was like blown away by that. I was like, what, really? Like, how can you? It just seems crazy to me, honestly. But yeah, I guess it's true. So,
I mean, I don't know how they're gonna do it too, since the game is still supposed to only span the time of 1 year. And I don't know.
Right. So every day you're getting something. I guess I don't know. That's the only way I can think of it.
From the way they said things, it looks like, or from the trailer I've seen at least, is that you can bounce back and forth from your overworld to your other world.
Right,
like the other Persona games, where you're constricted by timing slots and annoyingness and stuff like that. But
I
understand the delay is for to make the game better, tune up the gameplay, you know, your 80 FPS, 20K resolution, but
80 FPS would be so pointless. Yeah. I think, honestly, they did intend to have it for PS3 out when they said in they could do that. It was manageable. But then the PS4, you know, they got into that, and then they realized, yeah, this is a next-gen experience we're making. And it sort of evolved into more of a PS4 game than mainly a PS3 game. I think that's largely to do why this game has been delayed this many times.
Probably. I can understand the first delay, because that was like literally the year after it was like officially announced, and I was like, okay, I can understand that, but another year, I was like, oh, man. The main reason is because it's just it was my most anticipated game of this year, and then just to see that awesome PV3 get shown in Let's Space, and then be like, oh, sorry, it's coming out next year, I was like,
oh. Honestly, I woke up that day, and I was like, alright, PV3 is gonna have some bad news. But, you know, I waited patiently, but yeah.
I was in denial. I knew it was gonna happen. I knew it was, but I was like, no, I don't want to believe it. I have faith.
You know, there's a lot of good things that happen at this event too, like the Persona 5 anime. That's okay. I'll stop.
But, don't get me started on that.
It's not always good to focus on the bad, right? That's how I personally feel about the whole experience that we had.
Now, before, you know, in anticipation of P5 coming out this year, rest in peace, I played Catherine through again one more time, and I pulled out a few things that might be brought over to Persona 5. We already saw the texting feature.
Right, the SNS, yeah.
And in Catherine, like I was saying, there was the text messaging feature, which you could receive photos from your members, but your other friends in the game. And I'm pretty sure that will play out in Persona 5 in a similar way of, like, taking pictures of, like, your next heist location.
Right.
And, like, plotting things out. That's just
Which is a cool thing they did in Devil Survivor, which I guess was sort of, like, a precursor to that, was, like, you know, at the end of each day, your friends and stuff would email you, you know, cool stuff like that. So it's kind of nice to see that sort of interaction with, you know, new means of technology being implemented in some of our beloved games. So, you know, I hope that does actually come back, because that makes sense, right?
Yeah. And, I mean, in Persona 4 and maybe 3, I can't remember because I haven't played 3 in, like, a long time, there was, like, a very bare-bones texting system where you could, like, let your friends know to come see a movie or something like that. It wasn't really anything impressive. But this time we got, like, a big red triangle.
Yeah, I mean, that has actually been confirmed to be, like, I think how we transport to the other palace or whatever.
The palace, get an app of some sort.
That's interesting. It's like the demon summoning app.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's kind of cool.
Drawing a lot of connections here with.
Yeah, that's kind of funny. And I wonder if there's a bit of inspiration there, but
yeah,
that definitely looks promising. A lot of people are like, all social links will be done on the phone. And it's like, no, I don't think we're that. I don't think we're that point at the
experience. I think it'll be like how in Persona 3 and 4, where if you like pray at the shrine or something like that, it'll increase your chance of upgrading your social link the next time you talk to that person.
Yeah, that could be a cool thing, but yeah, we didn't see any social links. I mean, unless the social links are somehow just super hidden, I just still find that super bizarre. We haven't even seen one.
I'm kind of glad they didn't, though, because I kind of want it to be a surprise when I play.
Oh, yeah, that's true. I mean, they could have shown off Ryuji's one, if he is gonna be one. I don't know. I mean, yeah, probably, but
my favorite part about Ryuji, though, or Ryuji, is that...
Don't I say? Yeah. I could be wrong.
I'm bad with my Japanese, too.
Yeah.
I like how in his character profile, it explicitly states that he is a bad influence on our main character.
And right, and I think that... Yeah, I'm not gonna be to cut you off. I think that could be really, really interesting, because it looks like he's, not the brightest student, to say the least.
He's definitely the Yosuke of this game.
Yeah,
except he's
totally
more like a rough nut type of dude.
I'm very interested to see how he'll be different, though, because, I mean, they can't repeat the same character.
I hope that Yosuke was annoying. No offense to Yosuke.
I like Yosuke. Everyone hates Yosuke, man.
He's just all, like, pure friendship adrenaline.
True.
Rush. But, I mean, he's not as bad as Junpei. I'll give him that.
Dude, oh my gosh, you're tearing me apart, man.
I think the only reason my pure hatred for Junpei came from the fact that one day my friend came over with a Junpei hat on, and I was like, okay, I think we've gone too far.
Oh, okay. Was he a fan of Shin Megami Tensei, or just...
I actually introduced him to the series with E3,
cool.
And Junpei was the character that really clicked for him for whatever reason, because the entire game, he hates you. And then
at the very
end, he's like, oh, I guess we're friends now, right? I don't know.
Well,
he called me a jerk the entire game, but...
Some people love him, some people hate him. I guess we'll just end it at that.
Yeah, I guess so.
I guess you know which part I'm on. But yeah, the TGS event, I feel like there's still more on the horizon, though. I feel like this is the breaking point, like... I don't know if you saw, but I made that video, like, speculating we're gonna get news on a release date soon. I was totally wrong that it'd be out this year in America, obviously.
I mean,
but
it's not really your fault, it's...
Right, but I think we're starting... I mentioned in the video that, like, there's a point where Atlas, you know, pops the bubble and, you know, information starts to, you know, fly out. I think we're starting to get to that point. It's slowly gonna ramp up.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure it'll come out a little bit before summer 2016. That's just a placeholder date.
Yeah, I'm thinking June.
Yeah, probably.
Personally. I mean,
June,
that's just me being hopeful.
June at the latest for me.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think... in Japan, obviously. I don't think a late September is gonna fly for Japan. That's usually not the best... Well, then again, Metal Gear came out. That's usually not the best for sales, if I recall correctly, so...
Yeah.
Not too sure.
Plus, Hashino himself said the game was, like, entirely done. They were like,
yeah, that's another thing. I'm very confused on that. Personally.
Yeah, they just said they were tuning up the gameplay, so, I mean, that can't take too long, can it?
Maybe they need to... We're tuning up the gameplay, aka making the rest of the game.
Yeah.
The other 50%. Yeah. Let's hope it comes out soon, you know?
Yeah. What was it? The next point that I wanted to pull out from Catherine, I know we strayed far from that topic, but morality.
Completely.
If you've ever played Catherine, you know your decisions in that game
right.
like affect the play out of the cutscenes. Like, you'll see, like, a little angel meter in the corner, depending on, like, what your alignment is. And, like, the cutscenes would play out different ways. Like, even if they were animated, they would cut to a different animation reel than another way would.
Yeah.
And that'd be interesting to see incorporated to P5. Now, I'm not saying P5 will have direct morality in it, because we've never really seen that in a Persona game, but I could see that, like, working, kind of, with, like, how your social link decisions work and things like that.
Well, technically, there was morality in Persona 1. It's like, what's it called? Do you save the nurse?
That,
and it's like, do all those stupid things just to get the right ending.
Press
but,
the red button or press the blue button.
So stupid. But, yeah, I think that could be really awesome. I don't know, honestly, if that'd be able to be incorporated because, well, then again, who knows? Because they did say it was such a big game. But, like, you gotta think about Catherine, super short, right?
Yeah, it was a good game, though.
Yeah, no, definitely one of the better releases for that year.
Yeah,
actually, that whole quarter, really.
Don't play underage kids. That one's not too good for the little ones.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Yeah, I had my sister come into my room. She's a little bit younger than me. A little while ago, and she's like, "Ooh, I saw PewDiePie play this," and I'm like, "You don't want to play this.
You should not be watching that." Okay, so the Persona game's probably not donning the M rating, but Catherine definitely like it.
Yeah.
A little more risque content there. So I don't know about that, but
yeah.
I don't know if they'd have the funds necessarily to do that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think so? Because I don't think they could remake any cutscenes like that.
The new animation studio they have, is like right. really, really good at their job, better than, you know, Giraffe Necks from P3 mm-hmm. P4.
Right.
And they appear to have a lot of cutscenes in that game, a lot more than
yeah. I noticed that from PV3. Either we're just getting like a big bulk of cutscenes, or like there is going to be a lot of the game animated. But then again, okay, I was thinking about this earlier today actually, and I saw the like the second promotional video for Persona 3, and it was pretty much all just cutscenes. Mm-hmm. So I don't. Who's to say, really?
Yeah.
But I'm excited to go to Egypt. It's yeah. just, I can't wait to play that. Oh, man. Just love.
I also pointed out a few things that could draw P5 to, like, the first two games, because I've been mm-hmm. noticing that Atlas is slowly starting to, like, recognize their abused children, known as Persona 1 and 2.
Right, and yeah,
they,
yeah.
I mean, they first started out with skin packs, you know, for, like, for P4 Dance and Ultimax.
Yeah, and Arena.
And yeah. Arena, yeah. And, Then we started to see P5, and there was a few elements we saw that were from the previous Persona games, like guns, the color red, which was the updated color scheme of P2. Originally, it was gray and purple, but the PSP release has since been red. And, like, there's the possible chance that, you know, how Arsene seems a little bit malicious.
Yeah, he's a little villainous, yeah, say the least.
In PV2, he constantly talks about, like, making those who go against your beliefs repent or something like that. Mm-hmm, I'm like, yeah. That's nothing Persona would usually say.
Yeah, it's not very, you know, stereotypical investigation team, nice guy. So, yeah, I kind of get that vibe from Austin also. Like, he doesn't seem like the nicest guy at the end of the day. But it'd be interesting to see if our own Persona sort of betrayed us or something. That'd be strange.
Kind of like Thanatos. I felt like that was a missed opportunity in P3, mm-hmm. that, like, you know, at the beginning of the game, Thanatos possessed our main character and broke free from Orpheus and, like, mm-hmm. kind of controlled right. the situation. We didn't really get to see that again later in the game. That was kind of
because we leveled up, bro. That's probably why. But yeah, I think something like that would be really cool. But aren't the guns in Persona 5? They stated they're not actual guns.
Yeah, they're like, yeah, only so work in the other
way. I always felt that was a little weird when you're doing the Snow Queen quest line. Like, it was just kind of like, guns in a school, that's not a good image.
No, don't take this the wrong way, because I don't intend it to be. But I was browsing the bowels of Armageddon one day, and I went in the comment section. Someone linked a fan fiction. Now, I don't condone Persona fan fictions. This is the only one I've read, I swear. But it was pretty funny, like, Tatsuya's brother from Persona 2, it was, like, a fan fiction where he meets the P1 cast, and he's like, oh my gosh, you won't believe how many, like, stuff I'll have to write off for you guys bringing guns to school or owning guns,
and
period.
Battle axes. I know, right? Oh, that's pretty funny, actually. Yeah. I just imagine that. That'd be an interesting exchange. And then they would fight, and then it would be Persona 1 and 2 Arena. But,
oh god.
Yeah, back to, TGS. So now the Famitsu interview is out, we're not going to really talk too heavily on that because it's officially not. It's still a leak, basically.
Yeah.
And we don't want to cross any borders there. But yeah. A lot of really promising information in there
mm-hmm.
about just the game in general. So,
yeah.
I want to talk about it. But it's really hard to resist.
Little bits and pieces here.
Yeah, I think that'll be okay.
Now, the one thing that struck me odd is, you know, in PV3, because it's kind of not all, this is not only restricted to the Famitsu, but it's also back at TGS. A little scene in PV3 when you turn into mice. Hashino said himself that's the status ailment, and I'm like, what?
Yeah, that's a little interesting. Like, will that like, if you don't cleanse that off in a battle, will you have to
be a mouse?
Yeah, I mean, I'm trying to think of how that would be incorporated. I think maybe, like, okay, someone, it's a status effect or something, like polymorph, and then, like, it persists through battle, so you have to find a cure or something, and then, like, your next battle, you're forced to get, you know, the enemy gets, like, a preemptive attack or something. I think that would be interesting, personally.
Yeah, maybe.
Or something to that degree. But.
What else was there? Another thing that I wanted to point out is that, the other world, basically, this palace that they're in, it's going to be built, it's, from the way they describe it, it's going to be torn up in blocks, kind of like Tartarus in P3. That's where we saw the pyramids and the art galleries and stuff.
Yeah. But is it going, okay, sorry.
No, it's fine. I was just going to say, it seems a little weird.
It seems a little weird, and I hope this is how they do it. So, like, the palace is actually a location, and yeah, your school is, like, maybe layer 1, but, like, the palace, like, you know, is scattered across the world or something, because it doesn't really make sense why your school would have an art gallery and a space observatory. Well, maybe, who knows? Yeah. I contradict myself every other second, it seems, but you know, it'd be interesting to see how they tackle that, because personally, I like the concept of Tartarus, of always just going higher and higher and higher, but it didn't look like the palace was actually that tall. So.
It seemed to be going forward than upward.
Right, so it's like, it makes you think, like, what exactly direction are they going
to
take that?
Are they on their road to glory?
Oh.
Road to
just a super long hallway for thousands of miles.
That's probably stretching it, but, you know.
Most likely, yeah, but well, I think whatever they choose, it's going to be great. Obviously, we move past the point where it's, you know, Persona 3 blocks for 57 floors.
Yeah.
A little ridiculous. You know, something a little more tame. Because, honestly, the hardest thing to, like, get people into talking about Persona is, like, for me to, like, sell people on the game, it's like, yeah, it's this really awesome story. You know, you got to do these social link things. And the combat's really fun, too. And then they get to the combat, and it's like, yeah, it's really fun, but the dungeons are kind of meh. And it's like, well, I guess they're not for everybody, but I really hope that Persona 5 will alleviate this by making it a little more engaging, to say the least.
Yeah, and another thing that struck me as odd, it's kind of cool, is that the dungeons won't be randomly generated anymore.
Well, I think they said in the February interview there are random aspects. Like,
yeah,
like
traps and stuff.
No, I think it's like some rooms will be like sort of randomly... I don't know how to describe it to you, but there was in the Hoshino interview thing on YouTube... There was, like, this one room that was very, like, bare bones, and it looked like it was randomly generated. Because, honestly, I love procedurally generated stuff, like roguelikes and stuff. So I hope we get, like, the best of both worlds. I mean, that's not totally out of the question, right?
Yeah. And, I mean, like, I prefer the, what's it called? The randomly generated dungeons, too. But, like, I feel like having pre-built dungeons would kind of open up P5 to a new generation before we get boarded by the people who were like, well, you're just filthy casual scum, you know, you play real shit on Gami Tensei game. I'm like, yeah. Well, you know, there's time for change sometimes.
I agree with that, yeah.
Yeah. And another thing that I don't understand is that, so you use this app to go into the other world, and you go there to hunt these people, which Hoshino states as rotten people, which I'm assuming each person correlates with each seven deadly sins, as we have
possibly
seen.
Possibly.
And as we know, the palace is built up from this school. So how did those rotten people get in your school?
That's what I'm thinking, because the one man in the suit that kind of sprouts the fly wings, he does... Unless he's the principal, I'm not too sure on him. So I'm thinking it's like maybe, I don't know, see, there's so many unanswered questions. This is why we had this discussion, huh?
Yeah, I don't think he's going to be beating up his teachers.
Right. I mean, how fun would that be, though, if you beat up Moroka? Like, Moroka was a shadow.
Yeah.
Oh, man, that'd be cool. But I'm having a pipe dream, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah, just super interested on all the things released from that. It was just... Just God, give me the game already, really. That's all I can think of. It's just, but I honestly do think, though, that there's, back to the whole dungeon thing, that it looks like perhaps this time we're going to be spending a lot more time in the dungeons. I don't know how you stand on this, but I disliked how in Persona 4 you had to either choose doing a social link or doing a dungeon, because I pretty much said, all right, you need to get good and do the dungeon in one day if you want to max everything out. I kind of liked in Persona 3 how it was like a nighttime thing.
Yeah, I mean,
how do you feel about that?
And I mean, it made it really difficult for achievement hunting.
Right, yeah, that was another thing. Just, and obviously, understand, you know, we're thieves by night and that stuff, but how is that going to exactly conflict with our, you know, schedule? I'm a little curious on that.
Most thieving does happen at night, though, so I mean...
Right, so, as you all know.
As it could be, possibly, maybe... You can only access it by night. I could be entirely wrong here, because we've seen in the corner, there's like clouds and like sun and stuff while they're in the dungeon. That could just be it's an early build and they haven't really messed with that yet. Or, you know, it's...
I'm not too sure. Yeah, now that you bring that up, because I don't... Okay, I have to disagree that I think that's an early build, but yeah, definitely when you're inside the dungeons, it does show the sunny icon, you know. You think it'd show a moon phase or something to that degree, but I don't think they're... Oh, that's a really good question.
Yeah.
When will... Because, okay, I'm not going to bring it up anymore. This is the last time I'm talking about the Famitsu thing, but there is a Famitsu thing where it looks like they're hanging out at, like, a sort of sight, and it seems to be like the sun's just setting. So
oh yeah, I know that picture, and it looks like they're in a building of some sort that's looking right, over yeah. the city, and I'm like, oh
yeah, it looks really cool obviously, but yeah. I'm a little, I don't know really, that's another thing I guess we'll, you know,
yeah,
figure out eventually.
So, we know a few things about the characters. I'm not going to go in with the new information from this Famitsu, but the stuff we've learned at TGS.
Mm-hmm.
I think the main character might be voiced, honestly.
Really?
I feel like it's going to be like Fallout 4. That's my
favorite. That would be interesting.
You know how in Fallout 4, like, you choose a dialogue option, and then the main character's voiced, and he says something slightly different, but it's basically the same thing. Yeah. I feel like that's what it's going to be like in P5.
That would be interesting.
Yeah. I mean, we saw that with Catherine, too. You would pick a dialogue option, and then what he said would be slightly different, but it's around the same premise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, see, I want to say that because it sounded like he was actually talking a lot in the most recent trailer. I could be wrong on
especially
that. Especially
in
been.
The live events, too.
Yeah, and it's like that at the post after the trailer was revealed, they had a special guest, the voice actor for Persona 5's main character. Yeah, yeah. And it's like, why would they bring him up if that wasn't the case? Obviously, this would be the first time that your playable character in a Persona game was not you, really.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, we had Tatsuya and Maya.
Yeah, but Tatsuya, that wasn't in... Okay, in Persona 2,
Crust
he was...
Boy and...
Yeah. So, I don't... Because, okay, back to the Famitsu. Gosh, I guess I gotta bring up that article all the time now.
Hey, man, by the time we get this editing done, maybe...
That is true, yeah. It'll probably be out. So I think it'll be okay, but...
Yeah.
It does say you. I think to that degree, like yourself,
mm-hmm.
He still doesn't have an official name, which is making me not point to, yes, he will be voiced, and maybe he won't be. I don't really know, but...
I mean, Fallout
that's an interesting idea.
Executing it well, I think.
Yeah. And I think maybe later down the line, Persona could attempt something to the same degree, but... The amount of, voiceless protagonists versus the, Vincent is a little, 20 years of tradition or most recent, I don't know.
They kind of force-fed the personality on Yunarakami, and I hope they don't do that with P5.
I mean, that's really if you only, would you say that's only if you take, the other game, the non-main game into consideration, like, the other... sources of media like the animation and
the animations I kind of disregard, but as we all know, Arena, Ultimax, and Dance are canon reason, and he's all stated as Yunarakami except Persona Q, because that one they were like
they couldn't fit him in there for some reason, but yeah, I mean, okay, I'd like them to have an official name later down the line, because that just makes sense from a marketing standpoint. You gotta call your figure something, mm-hmm. right? Usually a canon name, I guess works in that degree, but I hope maybe we just don't get it for a little while. That's really what I want from that.
I think if they milk the plump cow that is P5 when it comes out,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I have a feeling that the reason they gave him the title The Phantom is so that if they do make spinoffs, possibly they won't be forced to give him a full name, and they can just title him as The Phantom. But that's just a guess. That's just pure speculation out of me.
It's like you go to school the first day, hey, what's your name?
The Phantom?
Well, you're weird. All right. See you later.
Hey, Mr. The Phantom. Did you hear about the Phantom Thief? No.
No way. Never heard of him.
But anyway, moving to the next character, we got Naruto, also known as Raiji mm-hmm. Sakamoto.
Yeah,
he is
usually...
a bad influence.
Dude, he's the worst. It's pretty funny, though. I kind of see some similarities to my own life in him, because that was kind of like at least from my high school experience, I hanged around some pretty bad characters. Okay, not bad characters, but I definitely see a lot of similarities to Ryuji and one of my friends, so it's a little funny for me, but mm-hmm. I like him so far. I don't know if he can excel or outdo any of the other, best friend characters we've had in the past.
I feel like he'll be a slightly more tame Kanji. Like, he won't be all up in your face saying that it'll beat you up, but he's, like, rough around the edges, but he's a softie on the inside.
Yeah, I'd like that. I like that. Mm-hmm. What I'm thinking is, like, maybe, honestly, his whole bad reputation or, like, that he's a bad guy is, kind of like Kanji. Like, it's all just, rumors and stuff of that nature, mm-hmm. which I think could be a really interesting social link, if he is one at all. But.
Mm-hmm. The next character we have is Anne Takamaki. Now, she reminds me a lot of people say she reminds her of Rise, but it reminds me of Ayase from Persona 1. I don't know her name in Revelations because localization. The blonde girl with the ponytails. I don't know.
I never get her. I don't even know her name.
It wasn't even that important.
The one in the warehouse, right?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I never got I got her once, but I don't like using her. Yeah, nothing's really of her character yet. I mean, all we know is that she is like a Caucasian or like a little bit Caucasian,
like quarter white.
Yeah, which is like why I think a little bit has something to do at least with her, you know, story. But outside of that, I don't really know what to make of her, honestly. I guess we'll see. Honestly, that's the biggest mystery for me. It seems like they really want to keep info on her kind of low for whatever reason, and I'm not sure why.
As we've seen in PV3, we see an emotional scene with her like breaking down and crying. Yeah, and stuff. I can't exactly remember what the translation said, but I feel like
The translation, I believe, translation was she wanted to she wished she could forget everything. Which is really bizarre. I don't know why.
I feel like she might be one of the most pivotal characters, more than
She's definitely gonna be the. Probably the main grill, let's be honest.
I don't know. We're gonna move on to the main grill,
right? Oh yeah. The cat. Morgana. Everyone loves the cat, man. Oh, no, she's not a cat. She's
not a cat.
She's more
the
than
great
that.
Morgana.
Right.
So now I did some research online to figure out, because Morgana, she said she's the great Morgana. I'm like, well, what could that be? Well, apparently, according to Arthurian legend, you know, King
Arthur. Yeah, Morgan Le Fay.
Morgan Le Fay, which is a sorceress of sorts, kind of like a counterpart of Merlin in a way.
What if she's actually that character? That would be an interesting twist.
Yeah.
That's my personal theory.
Because sorcery can involve many things like shapeshifting, and as we know, Morgana can shapeshift between a normal cat, cartoon cat, for whatever reason.
So maybe this fictional character found a way to turn herself into a cat and also become immortal.
Okay,
that'd be interesting. We've had weirder things, right?
Speculation time. Come on, grab all your friends. Let's go to very strange lands. Let's talk about possibly, that Morgana, let's just say that, yes, Morgana is Morgan Le Fay. What if she casted a spell on herself to turn herself into a cat, and it's almost irreversible?
Maybe that's her, motivation to, help out the Phantom, etc.
Like, sure, her ulterior motive is to be like, I want to turn back to normal and you guys will help me.
Right. And she kind of doesn't convey that in the beginning or something like that. Then that brings up the question, why she have freaking Zoro if she's more Morgan Le Fay? Who knows?
I really thought your idea of Puss in Boots made sense.
I stand by my Puss in Boots.
Okay.
And that sounds
if
very odd out of
context. She has to at least have like an iteration or an upgrade that's Puss in Boots.
All I'm saying is, starts out as Zoro, evolves into Puss in Boots. That's gonna happen. It's gonna trade the rapier for a giant. No, Puss in Boots technically used a rapier too. I don't really know, but okay. Here's my defense. Teddy's persona, Kentucky Doji, that was a guy in mythology, and then he turned into the bear god. So is it that far fetched? I don't know. I still feel like I'm right, personally. But this isn't about my theories.
This is just a theory.
Yeah,
a game
exactly.
Theory. Wrong show, but whatever.
Right.
Next character is Yusuke Kitagawa. Now I'm going to butcher his name between Yosuke and Yusuke so much it's going to bother the heck out of me. But he says he has his own problem that he's dealing with in his life, and drama happens when he encounters our other characters. And as we know, he's an artist of some sort, or he's like, what is it?
He's a painter.
Yeah, an underling of a famous artist or something. So, I mean, the main theme of the game is breaking free from your chain, so maybe he's like, I don't want to be in this mentorship anymore.
Yeah, he's like, that'd be an interesting idea. Like, he was raised to be an artist or something, or, he feels that's his only, skill is that or something. Speculating, as always. And, turns out he doesn't actually like to do that.
Yeah. And, I mean, I don't know if you ever realized, but in Persona games, their personas usually represent the game in some way. Like, in Persona 4, almost all of the other party members' personas were children of Izanagi. And that can be linked back to, like, Yunarakami, like, getting them together to be friends to fight Izanami, the main bad guy. Or Persona 3, when the main character fuses Orpheus and Thanatos to make Messiah, which is basically like a man facing his death and coming back to life, like Jesus Christ himself.
And also a pretty predominant person in Greek, so that's... Wait, what?
I was agreeing with you, yeah.
Oh, okay, gotcha. So, yeah, I think this time they're very scattered about. We're not going to, you know, talk too much about the personas, but...
Well, yeah.
How exactly they delve into the whole Picaresque ideal, it's going to be very interesting to see, I think. Because so far, none of them are necessarily villains, but they're not really, like, good guys either. So it's...
Yeah.
It's more of the moral ambiguity... being a thief, I guess. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's what they're going for.
Yeah.
How will that play into Yusuke? Who the frick knows? I'm excited.
I have an idea.
Okay, let me hear it.
As I was saying earlier, how like the personas kind of represent how the story's going to play out. What if the fate of their personas, like the characters, like the fate of Arsene Lupin in his last novel, or the fate of Goemon is the fate of our main characters in some degree?
Yeah. That'd be interesting.
Like, Yusuke, maybe he goes under fire, kind of like how Goemon was burned or boiled.
What I'm thinking about that is he will be a ice or a wind persona of some degree, and he'll be weak to fire, but hey, that's just me. I don't think he'll be necessarily related to a story in a way, because if that, you know, maybe.
I mean, he has a Kabuki mask, which is what the story of Goemon's usually portrayed in Kabuki plays and stuff like that in Japan. So, I mean, it's just food for thought.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of examples, because I can't think of, did Hermes lose any? No, okay, we're not going to spoil any games for anybody here, but, you know, that could definitely be a possibility, but, I'm trying to think. I mean, there's a lot more we could obviously discuss about, but are there any last points you'd like to get in?
I'm mostly thinking about how the story is omnibus. Like, if you know what I mean, that's what Hashino said, is that the story's omnibus, like an omnibus kind of storytelling, which is really weird. They said that there's not going to be one main bad guy. It's just going to be kind of like shonen villain of the week.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking of. It's like, are we superheroes now?
Yeah.
It's very, very different. Like, you know, we have to have a final boss, obviously. Like, what are they going to do about that? I mean, maybe I feel like that's just a little bit of like teasing to the fans, like, oh yeah, there's no primary villain. But it'd be interesting to see if, you know, there's not a unified group that we're going up against. It's just, you know, each bad guy happens to be bigger and badder than the last, you know?
Yeah.
I think that'd be, honestly, or very refreshing.
Yeah, and aren't there, like, nine rings of hell or whatever? Like,
yes.
Each one representing each seven deadly sins, but there's, like, the uber mega bad one.
There's the worst, and pretty much if you're Judas, that's where you go.
Yeah.
Those are pretty much the two worst. So, you know, that could be interesting, definitely.
Like, the final boss could be like an iteration of Satan or Lucifer. Mm-hmm. I know that's going like deep into...
Well, technically Lucifer... Technically Lucifer, I think, is Pride, so...
Yeah.
Could be that.
But,
sorry to crap on your theory, but, it'd be very interesting if they did use the, you know, Dante's Inferno sort of conception of hell for our bosses. That'd be very... I think that could work, honestly.
Yeah, like, each Persona game has roughly around seven main dungeons and, like, a few others from...
Ish, yeah. Yeah.
And so, like, I could see it, like, being nine dungeons and each block of the palace is, like, going through a ring of hell, like Dante's Inferno, which is...
Because, you know, I hate to bring up Devil Survivor again, but it's a really good point, because, you know, early on... You figure out that, you know, the bosses you're encountering that are different than demons are all named after stars in the Big Dipper, so maybe it could be a thing going on there.
Like, Devil Survivor 2's, I feel like it's a lot like Evangelion, but...
Mm-hmm. Right, that's what I was saying. Yeah. I swear they're different, but no.
Yeah.
But,
What was it that I was going to bring up? You know, in the end of PB3, I don't know if you watch too much anime like I used to. I don't do it as much anymore. But,
I don't.
But I used to, like, be big into that kind of stuff, but not really anymore. I used to watch this anime. I finished it. It's probably one of my favorite animes of all time was Code Geass. And I've seen
I've seen that one.
I've seen the connection being brought up a few times, but you can't lie to me that the Phantom walking up in the big projector, that's totally zero.
Yeah, it's... I can definitely see some similarities. And if this show, or our story here, ends anyway like that series, That'd be kind of crazy.
I feel like Persona 3 might have multiple endings, and one of those endings might result in the martyr of the Phantom.
Hmm. Or I mean, Persona 5. You said Persona 3. I was like, Persona yeah, 5, Persona yeah. 3. It could have multiple
endings. Persona 3 did end in a martyr, too.
Yeah. But, a little bit. But,
yeah.
Let's, you know, let's hope that's not the case. Let's hope everyone lives. Yeah. As unlikely as that may be.
One thing that I really hoped to see again, since the whole theme of P5 with masks, that was Philemon. I can't. Mm-hmm. I want him back.
I don't think he's going back.
Probably not.
But we don't need him anymore.
No, we don't. But I want him back.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, he makes slight appearances at the beginning of every game as a blue butterfly. But
I think the brief homages are okay, to be honest with you. But that I guess that's a debate for another day. Is there any other points you'd like to touch on?
There was one. Okay. That was kind of key. What was it? I had it on the tip of my tongue. Oh, yeah. The thing that I think most people might have gotten over it now, but I remember back when PV2 and PV1 came out, everybody was assuming our main characters were turning into personas, and I proved myself right. Because, you know, mm-hmm. I'm prideful. That's not a thing.
Case. That's not the Visual Devil Saga-esque battle system. Apparently not very popular.
Well, no, their main key point to the argument was that the main characters got yellow eyes, but if...
Oh, you mean he was turning into a...
Persona, yeah.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I don't want to get on my high horse or anything because I sound like a complete jerk, but mm-hmm. I constantly brought up in threads talking about how if you look at the concept art for P1, P2, and even Izanagi from P4, personas have yellow eyes under their masks. Yeah. So I'm like, it's kind of obvious that they're activating their personas in a way, but most people jump ship to the shadow theory.
Right, I mean, I guess people aren't very used to seeing, you know, sort of, I don't want to say villainous, but not necessarily a super heroic sort of thing, activating your persona for the first time, because, you know, Narukami had the glasses on, so we technically couldn't see his eyes, but mm-hmm. when he had Izanagi, you know, he was a little happy, a little devilish grin, I'd like to say, so.
And when P3 protagonist activated his persona, his eyes turned, like, a light blue.
Right, you know, he was pretty... It's pretty happy with that smile. Yeah. It's pretty iconic from the series. But
now, I know you're trying to avoid the topic, so I won't go into it too much.
Okay.
I'll try to stay on surface with it. Mm-hmm. In PV3, we did see something that was questionable. I would just put it up on screen right here instead of talking about it and let you make your assumptions on what it could be. But I was assuming that if you've ever... This sounds really cheesy at first, but if you let me go through with it, it'll make sense.
No, go for it, dude. Four zeros.
If you played the... Persona. It's Spider-Man 1, 2, and 3. Those games.
What? I was not expecting that reference, but keep going. Sorry.
In those Spider-Man games, you walked around town, and you got random blips of when mm-hmm. people were being attacked or a crime was going on.
Yeah.
And quite possibly, I was thinking... that during these certain events, you know, like that unfortunate woman in that event.
Yeah, the woman getting attacked.
You could be walking past the alleyway which that event is happening.
That would be cool.
Spider-Man ham and kick some butt. But, you know, that was just my
I think that'd be... I think that'd be really cool. Because we obviously have a big world to explore if there was some sort of, like... I don't know how you'd really describe that necessarily, but... Something to that degree could definitely be possible with this large of a city and the many locations we're visiting, you know?
Mm-hmm. And, what was it? I also like to think that this game drew inspiration from Yakuza, and I know it probably didn't, and they were developing it before the Index buyout, but I can totally see them walking through Shibuya, totally like Yakuza. Like, the gameplay just looks so similar, like walking through Tokyo and stuff, but...
Well, I actually haven't played too much Yakuza, but... I can see that, and it agree. The question remains, though, are we going to travel around everywhere with our squad, I guess?
Maybe.
I mean, I don't know. It seems like it'd be hard to stealth that many people all in the same area. Hmm.
Plus,
I guess we'll have to see.
Plus, didn't it seem that P5 has a bigger budget? Like, I'm not too well-rounded in Japanese voice actors and knowing who they are, but from what I've heard, people are saying these are big-name Japanese mm-hmm. voice actors.
Oh, definitely. I know a little bit about the voice cast, and they're definitely, like, I don't want to say, you know, they're up there, basically.
Mm-hmm.
the higher echelon, I guess. So I think, probably their voice talent has been upgraded a bit. Not to say they're bad by any means in the past.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, these are the big guys, I guess, you know, because now they want to be a part of this big project. I'm pretty sure it's, like, one of the most anticipated games of, like, pretty much ever for Japan, too.
Yeah, so. Definitely. And, I mean, the last point I want to bring up is, what is your standing on dual audio?
I don't really use it, so, I mean, it seems like...
English voices.
Yeah, every English voice actor for pretty much all the games I've pretty much enjoyed. I think they've all done their role fantastically. Honestly, I feel like it's an insult to, like, ask for dual audio unless it's just horrible, which Atlas really hasn't had a bad one yet, I want to say.
The only questionable decision in Atlas's voice acting is probably casting Johnny Yong Bosch as both the main bad guy and the main good guy.
Say what you will. I love that they did that. It was just awesome to me. But we'll not spoil anything for anybody. Just,
yeah, that's why I didn't bring up any names.
Maybe I'm just a big fan of Johnny Yong Bosch.
Johnny Yong Bosch is my man.
He's probably one of my favorites. I'm just gonna throw that out there. But maybe a little questionable, sure, but I think it worked out okay.
And before people jump ship and just saying your casuals ruining the anime world, I just want to say I usually watch anime in subs. It's just the Persona cast is really good at their job that I can't help but listen to it. And honestly, I know he's a very talented man, and I respect him, and I'm sad that he passed away. It was really sad to have someone of that legacy go away, but I could not stand the guy who did Igor's original Japanese voice.
Really?
Yeah, he was all like, I'm Igor!
I really enjoyed him a lot. I mean, I think it's Igor talking in the new game. I could be incorrect on that, but I really enjoyed the one they had in the, you know, other games. Especially our new Igor voice actor. I really think he did a fantastic job, too. But that never really bothered me. I don't understand why people really love, you know, just the dual audio option so much. I guess it's just not my forte, but...
Probably used to think they're in the mindset of how English voice acting is always bad, but honestly, in the past few years, it's been getting better.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly believe there is very talented people in America. The problem is we don't have that many, so that's maybe why people are frowned on it so much. But oh well, what are you gonna do? Differing opinions, but yeah, that's pretty much all we really wanted to talk about. We talked a lot of, you know, listen, talk about Spider-Man for a couple minutes.
Spider-Man's cool, man. I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I didn't draw that comparison, but that could totally happen. And yeah, we just talked about, you know, our general thoughts from, keep wanting to say E3. It was pretty much my E3 for me.
Japanese E3.
But from TGS, obviously, we just wanted, we thought this would be kind of a cool thing to do. And yeah, thanks for coming out.
Do you have any final points you want to bring up? Or
nah, that's pretty much it. A game coming out. Let's play it.